louder salawat for the love of the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam. A third salawat for the love of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. If we look at the Quran and examine it, we would see that the Quran can be divided into three sections, three categories. Scholars say that there is one section of the Quran, one group of verses in the Quran that discuss the verses of aqaid, the verses that have to do with the ideology. And these are the verses that speak about tawheed. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ. This is a verse, Surah Al-Tawheed by itself. The verses that speak about the oneness of Allah. The verses that speak about the Day of Judgment, Ma'ad. The verses that are related to our ideology, our aqidah. This is one group of verses in the Quran. And scholars say there's another type of verses, another group of verses, another category, and that is the category of the fiqh verses, the verses of jurisprudence, the verses of ahkam, the verses that tell us to pray, to fast, to do hajj, and how to perform the wajibat. Scholars say there are about 500 verses in the Quran that are related to the fiqh. And we take our fiqh from the Quran. We take our rulings from the Quran. That is the first source that we use. And then there is a third category, a third group of verses, and these are what the scholars call the akhlaqiyat, the verses of ethics, the verses of morality and virtues, the verses that discuss and teach us how to deal with one another, how to speak to one another, how to walk, how to talk, the rights of the people around us, the rights of the parents, the verses that discuss the family and the children. And we see there are many verses in the Quran that focus on this aspect of our life and this very important issue. We look at the stories in the Quran, the story of Prophet Yusuf, the story of Prophet Musa, the stories of Prophet Isa. All of these stories, they discuss and they show us ethics and virtues. And it's all, these are role models for us, the prophets of Allah. And it shows us how the prophets of Allah pray and ask Allah and how they speak to Allah. This all falls under the category of akhlaq, manners and ethics. And when we look at the verses in the Quran, we see that the family is mentioned in numerous verses in the Quran. Many verses in the Quran speak about the family and the role of the family, the structure of the family. And we see prophets praying to have a good progeny, to have a good family in the Quran. Why do we have so many verses that discuss the family? Why do we have so many verses that discuss akhlaq and morality? Because the religion of Islam, it's a package. The religion of Islam is a complete religion. It's a way of life. And this is why every single aspect in our life is pointed. And it's mentioned in the Quran. If we look at the Quran, we see there are verses in the Quran where the prophets, they would ask Allah to have a progeny and to have good spouses and to have a healthy, structured family. Allah shows us the dua of Prophet Zakariya alayhi salam. وَزَكَرِيَّا إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ رَبِّ لَا تَذَرْنِي فَرْدًا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ. Zakariya, he asks Allah, he tells him, "Oh Allah, don't leave me alone. Give me a progeny." Because Zakariya reached a very old age and he did not have children. He did not have a progeny. And he prays, he asks Allah. In another verse, Allah mentions the dua of Zakariya, Surah Maryam. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ayn, Sad, Dhikru Rahmati Rabbika Abdahu Zakariya, Idh Nada Rabbahu Nida'an Khafiyya. قال ربي إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا. He tells him, Allah says remember the mercy of Zakariya, the mercy of Allah upon Zakariya. When he went to Allah in the mihrab, he tells him, Oh Allah, my bones have become frail and my head and my beard has become gray. Habli min ladunka. Give me a child, give me a progeny, someone who will inherit from me once I die. And then Allah gives him Yahya. Allah gives him Yahya, the prophet of Allah, who is very close in resemblance to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, because they were both butchered. They were both beheaded, and both of their heads were taken to the tyrant of their time. And Allah took revenge from the ones who killed Yahya, John, and Allah also will take revenge from the ones who killed Hussein ibn Amir al-Mu'mineen. Allah discusses how Zakariya, he sees a miracle. Allah says, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَّ الْمِحْرَابِ. Every time Zakariya, he enters on Maryam, because Zakariya, he was taking care of Maryam. He was her uncle. Every time he enters in the mihrab, he would see that there was food in front of Maryam. There was rizq in front of Maryam. He would tell her, أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا. Where is this from? She would tell him, هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. This is from Allah. Zakariya, it was his role to bring the food to Maryam. He would come and he would see that there is already food. She would tell him, this is from Allah. Allah gives anyone who asks him. And then at that moment, Zakariya, هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. At that moment, when he saw a miracle in front of his eyes, he asked Allah for a child and Allah gave him a child. We see the family is discussed in the Quran. There are many verses. Another verse, Allah says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَن لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah has decreed that you do not worship anyone other than Allah and have ihsan with your parents. What does ihsan mean? With people, normal people, we are obliged to deal with them with equality and justice. Meaning that if someone hurts me, I have the right to take revenge from this person. This is justice. But with parents, Allah says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. With parents, you have to deal with them with ihsan. Meaning that you always have to be the muhsin. You always have to do the good. You always have to try. Ihsan means you don't wait for your parents to ask you for something. You go and you give it to them before they ask you. You don't wait for them to tell you, take me to the doctor, bring me food, bring me medicine. You go and you ask them, do you need this? This is ihsan. And Allah says, ihsan of parents is ordered immediately after tawheed. Allah says, no one is allowed to worship anyone other than Allah. The second ruling, right after, he says, and treat your parents with ihsan. Allah does not mention other issues. He goes to the rights of the parents. And we see many prophets doing dua, many prophets asking Allah to have a healthy, to have a sound family. And of course, when you do dua for a healthy family, these prophets, they would do dua for a physical health and more importantly, spiritual health. And we see that Rasulullah, he also does a dua for family. رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنْ وَاجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Oh Allah, grant us from our spouses and our children joy for our eyes. and make us the imam of the muttaqeen. This is the tafsir of this verse is very clear. Tafsir, the translation, the exegesis of this verse is very clear. When we ask Allah to bring us joy for our eyes through our progeny and through our children. But sometimes a verse, it has tafsir and it has ta'wil. It has a hidden meaning. It has a deeper meaning. It has a meaning that the imam gives us. And the imams, they tell us that the ta'wil of this verse, the deeper meaning of this verse, some verses, they have a deeper meaning and an apparent meaning. For example, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. We have given you the pond of Kawthar. The tafsir of this verse is the pond of Kawthar on the Day of Judgment. The ta'wil, the deeper meaning of this verse is Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. She is the Kawthar of Rasulullah. And in this verse, Rabbana hablana min azwajina wa dhurriyatina qurrata a'yun waj'alna lilmuttaqina imama. The ta'wil of this verse, oh Allah, grant us from our spouse, this is Khadija, the wife of Rasulullah. Wa dhurriyatina, and our progeny, this is Fatima al-Zahra alayha salam. Qurrata a'yun, joy for our eyes. Those are Hassan and Hussein. Waj'alna lilmuttaqina imama, is none other than the imam of the muttaqeen, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. We see that even the prophets of Allah, they would beg Allah and they would ask Allah in their du'as to give them a healthy, sound family, a family that is mu'min, a family walad salih, a family that is healthy in iman. Why? Because this was an issue that even the prophets of Allah, they would find a struggle in. Today, when you find struggle raising your children in this society, when you find struggle maintaining an Islamic family in this society, know that you're not the only one. Even the prophets of Allah, they had to deal with this. Even the prophets of Allah, they were not immune. And why would the prophets ask? Why are the prophets constantly asking Allah? In another verse, Rabbi awzi'ni an ashkura ni'mataka allati an'amta alayya wa ala waliday. Oh Allah, grant me the opportunity to thank you and thank Allah. Thank Allah for my parents and my family. And give me a dhurriya salihah. Why do the prophets ask about this? This is because when we die, there's only a few things that's going to remain from me. A person that lives in this life for 80, 90, 100 years, when they die, they leave everything they worked for in this life. Except a few things remain. And this is a famous hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He says, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمَ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When the son of Adam dies, when a human being dies, he will be disconnected with this life, except three things connect this person to this life. صَدَقَ جَارِيَةً, paying a charity that is continuous. A charity that continues. After this person dies, you see that he paid, he gave something for a charity that for 100 years, for 200 years, people benefit from. Like building a masjid, for example. Building a hospital. Helping build an orphanage. These are all things that will remain after we die. And people will come here and they will pray and they will practice. And they will do anything that's good, and the reward will go to the one who donated, even if this person is in his grave. Sadaqa jariya, aw ilmun yuntafa' bih, or a type of knowledge. You teach someone something, you guide someone to the right path. Once you're dead, these people are guided. These people are using that knowledge that you taught them. Every time they use that knowledge, you will receive thawab. And the third, وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُو لَهُ. To have a son, to have a progeny, to have a family that will pray for you after you die. They pray for you, Allah will fix your situation in the grave. And this is why we pray, this is why we are, it's always recommended for us to pray for our parents, to pray for our grandparents, remember them, give sadaqah on their behalf, go to hajj on their behalf, pray on their behalf if they have not prayed. Because this is the only thing that's going to remain from me. And this is why we see that the prophets of Allah, they would insist on the dua to have a good progeny, to have a well-structured, well-founded family. Prophets of Allah, they would ask Allah. But we see that even some of the major prophets of Allah, some of the known prophets of Allah, they struggled with the issue of the family. Some of the ulul azm prophets, like Prophet Nuh, Prophet Lut, they were tested with their family. And I mentioned, there are some people where Allah does not test them through prayer, through hajj, through zakat, through khums. Because when it comes to prayer, they're the first person praying. When it comes to hajj, he goes to hajj every year. When it comes to salat al-layl, he prays salat al-layl every night. But when it comes to raising a proper family, you see that the best of us fail. You see that the best of us struggle. Even the mu'mineen, they find a difficult time convincing their children to come to the masjid, convincing their family members to wear hijab, convincing the family to pray on time and maintain an Islamic family. This is a difficult, this is a challenge. And the prophets of Allah, they had to deal with this as well. Allah says in the Quran, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Allah has given an example of the kuffar, who? The wives of Nuh and Lut, who were two prophets of Allah. They were chosen prophets. But their wives, they were not good women. Their wives were not good people. And their relationship with their husbands did not help them. And Allah gives us another example of an honorable woman whose husband was a tyrant, and that was Asiya bint Muzahim, the wife of Fir'aun, who believed in Prophet Musa and believed in Allah. Musa began to punish her. He began to torture her. He placed her, he tied her hands and her legs to the ground, and he placed a very huge rock on her chest. And she was being tortured and tortured. At that moment, she says, رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنِ. Oh Allah, I don't want the palace of Fir'aun. I don't want the mansion of Fir'aun. I want a small house in paradise. Save me from Fir'aun. Take all of this away from me. I don't want this lifestyle. I want to believe in Allah, even if I have a small house in paradise. Of course, Allah gave her the heavens, and Allah saved her from Fir'aun. So we see that the family is very important, and preserving the family is a very critical issue. And many of us are tested with this. Rasulullah, he was even tested with this. Rasulullah, Allah gave him the Ahlul Bayt who are purified in the Quran. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. But Rasulullah, he was also tested with his wives. There are verses in the Quran that threaten the wives of Rasulullah. يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيِّ لَسْتُنَّكَ أَحَدٍ مِّنَ النِّسَاءِ. O wives of the Prophet, you are not like the other women. The verses threaten them and scold them. مَنْ يَأْتِ مِنْكُنَّ بِفَاحِشَةٍ. Whoever does anything haram, her adab will be multiplied and it will be tripled. So we see that even Rasulullah, sometimes he had a difficult time with the closest people to him, the family. So the family is very important. And this is why we must learn how to preserve the family, how to maintain the family. However, we live in a society where preserving the family and maintaining the family is a very difficult task. It's not easy. No one can guarantee that once you get married, you will have a very easy way dealing with the family. Every day we hear of divorces. Every day we hear of fights. Every day we hear of struggles. Every day we hear parents losing their children. Every day we hear members of the family falling apart, and there's no love, there's no care, there's no attention in the family. Many of us, we know very well how to build relationships with strangers. When it comes to strangers, this person is the best in PR. This person is the best in building relationships. But you see that same person, when it comes to building a relationship with his whole own household, his own wife, her husband, his children, his family members, his parents, you see that this person struggles. Some of us, we struggle. We don't know. We don't know how to show love. We don't know how to care. We don't know how to communicate with the closest people to us. We spend most of our time investing our time and our efforts with strangers. And we have left our family. We have left our children. We don't invest time with our children. On the day of judgment, when I die, who's going to help me? Who do I need? Who do I expect to read dua? And who do I expect to read Quran over my grave? My boss? My coworker? Or my children? But unfortunately, many of us, we are too caught up in this lifestyle. Too caught up in this lifestyle that only teaches us about money. Make money. Spend your time. Invest your time in money. We have made the money. We all have money, alhamdulillah. We all, no one is sleeping hungry in this society. But how many of us sleep without connecting with our family members? How many of us sleep with qati'at al-rahim? There's no silah between the family members. How many spouses sleep not talking to one another? How many children sleep not connecting with their parents? I see some, they tell me, it's been months and years that they have not talked to their parents. This is haram. This is one of the greatest sins, to cut the relationship with the family, specifically the parents. However, when we look at the religion of Islam, we see that the religion of Islam stresses on the importance of the family structure, maintaining a well-established family. And the most sacred institution in Islam is the institution of the family. Rasulullah says, مَا بُنِيَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ بِنَاءٌ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنَ التَّزْوِيجِ. There is no foundation, no structure more beloved to Allah than the structure of family, the structure of marriage. This is a sacred institution. When you get married قُرْبَةً إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, because Allah will reward you. And this is a sacred institution. And the Ahlul Bayt, the Quran, teaches us to invest in the family, to spend quality time with the family. Rasulullah, he stood in front of the Muslims in his own mosque, and he tells them, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. He says, the best out of you, O Muslims, is the one who is the best towards his own family. The best is not the one who knows how to pray the whole night. Yes, this is good from one perspective. But if you want to take a look at the holistic view, the best out of you is the one who is the kindest, the best with his own family. And when I say family here, I'm discussing our relationship with our parents, my relationship with my spouse, my relationship with my children, my relationship with my brothers and sisters. This is what the religion of Islam teaches us. Rasulullah, he says, the best out of you is the one who is the best towards his own family. And then he tells them, and I am the best towards my family. This is why Rasulullah is a role model. إن لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. In Rasulullah, you will find the best role model. The best role model when it comes to prayer, when it comes to closeness to Allah, and also when it comes to building and maintaining a relationship with the family. Some of us, we say, yes, we take Rasulullah as a role model, and all we do is pray, but we don't have a relationship with our family. How am I following the sunnah of Rasulullah when I'm leaving a main component of the sunnah of Rasulullah? One day, the companions of Rasulullah, there were a few companions who their minds were closed. Like you see some people today in the name of Islam. These people, some of them would worship the whole night. Some, they would fast all day. Some, they would fast the whole year. They got with one another and they began talking to one another. This person, he says, I pray every single day. This person says, I pray all of the night. The other one says, I fast every day out of the year. After concluding, after talking to one another, they said, we are better than Rasulullah. Because Rasulullah, he's not fasting every day. Rasulullah, some of them, they said, we don't get married. We don't have a relationship with women. We don't get married. So this means that we are better. So they came and they said, we are better than Rasulullah. They came to Rasulullah and they tell him, this is what we do and we are better than you. Rasulullah tells them, I sleep parts of the night and I wake up and I pray parts of the night. Because Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلِ قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا نِصْفَهُ half of the night. أَوْ انْقُصْ مِنْهُ قَلِيلًا أَوْ زِدْ عَلَيْهِ وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنِ تَرْتِيلًا. He says, I sleep parts of the night and I pray parts of the night. I fast some days out of the year and I break my fast some days out of the year. And I get married. And then he says, الزواج سنتي فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني. Marriage, family is my sunnah, the sunnah of Rasulullah. And whoever does not want the sunnah of Rasulullah, then this person is leaving the millah of Rasulullah, leaving the religion of Rasulullah. Rasulullah teaches us to have a well-maintained family, to have a relationship with the family. And we see that Imam al-Husayn, he did the same thing. He also invested in the family. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, one of his biggest investments that kept his name alive until today was his relationship with his family. And taking the family with him to Karbala, this was an investment of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he came and he asked Imam al-Husayn, he tells him, why are you going to Karbala? Why are you going to Iraq? They're going to betray you. He tells him, Sha Allah an yarani shahida. Allah has destined that I become a shaheed. And then he tells him, if you are going to become a shaheed, then why are you taking the women and the children with you? He tells him, Sha Allah an yarahunna sabaya. Allah has destined that they become prisoners of war. Why? So that they revive the name of Imam al-Husayn. So that they carry the name of Imam al-Husayn wherever they go. If the family, if the women of Imam al-Husayn were not there, who was going to deliver the message of Imam al-Husayn after he was slain in the Battle of Karbala? It was Zainab, it was Kulthum, it was Rabab, it was Sukaina who gave us the message of Imam al-Husayn. It was the family that was taken captive. They were the ones that spread the message of Imam al-Husayn even after he was killed. Imam al-Husayn, he invested in his family. Do we invest in our family? Do we take time to invest and build a relationship and maintain a relationship with our family? Today, many of us struggle. You find some people, their biggest challenge is to maintain a relationship with their family. They don't know how to talk to one another. They don't know how to strike a conversation. They don't know how to keep a conversation without it ending into an argument. Whereas we see the religion of Islam insist on the family and the foundation of the family, the structure of the family. How should we show love? How should we build a relationship with the family? What is required of me to show my love to the family? Today, many people, they have their own idea. Many people, they have their own theories as to how to show love to the family. Some people, they say, yes, I know how to show love with my family. I just take out my wallet and I start giving a few dollars. I'll do that and I'll make them all happy. This is the reality today. Some of us, we think that we can, that money will bring us happiness. Some people, they think they can satisfy the family through money, and others, they think that the only way of someone else showing love to them is through money. Whereas we see the religion of Islam teaches us something which is the exact opposite. Money does not necessarily bring happiness. Money is a means. Money is a tool. Happiness is the goal. Sometimes it takes you to happiness, but not always. This is why you see many of the very rich, very wealthy couples. They get married, then after 30 days, after 2 months, 3 months, they break up. And they're millionaires and billionaires. Money did not bring them happiness. The religion of Islam tells us what brings us happiness. But unfortunately, we live in a society that all of our thinking and all of the thinking of this society is about money, capitalism. All of the thinking today, Christmas. How many people actually remember Prophet Isa? How many people actually uphold the values of Jesus? How many people remember Jesus? How many people connect to Jesus? Unfortunately, Christmas has become a means of advertisement, a means to commercialize, a means to boost the economy. And we see all the holidays. And unfortunately, we Muslims are also falling in this trap. The religion of Islam tells us, if you want to show love, there are ways. Allah has given us ways. But unfortunately, many of us, we are so used to dealing with society, dealing with money, because money brings happiness. So we come and we also do this at home. If I see my children upset with me, here's a few dollars. If I see my wife upset with me, here's a few dollars. Where that's not the case in the religion of Islam. The religion of Islam has given us a criteria, rules, and a structure as to how to have a proper family. Allah says in the Quran, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. From the signs of Allah, from the miracles of Allah, is that He created from amongst you spouses. This is a miracle from Allah. This is a sign from Allah that He created the genders, the male and the female. Isn't this a miracle from Allah? Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ. He created for you, from yourselves, from amongst yourselves, spouses. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. So that you find sukoon with one another. What's sukoon? Sukoon is comfort. Sukoon is stability. When you get married, you will be stable. You will find stability in your life. Of course, today, with the marriages today, the way marriages are going today, as soon as someone gets married, he loses all stability in his life. But the religion of Islam has given us a criteria. The religion of Islam has given us a way. There is an answer to every problem in the Quran. The Quran, Allah has given us a solution. Today, society has left the spouses and they have found other means. Marrying the same genders. And day after day, states in the United States, I don't know the rules, the law here in Canada, but day after day, month after month, they're allowing this to happen. Allah says, I have given you a miracle. There's وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, from the signs of Allah that we have created for you, spouses from one another, but they have left the signs of Allah and they find other means. And then when they are struck with diseases and when they are struck with catastrophes and adab, then they don't know where to go. Then Allah says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً. Allah has given you the first key, the first means of having a satisfied family, and that is mawaddah. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً. Allah has brought mawaddah between the family. What's mawaddah? Mawaddah is showing the love. Who are we ordered to have mawaddah with? One group is the Ahlul Bayt. قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. We are ordered to show love to the Ahlul Bayt. It's our wajib, it's our obligation. Now sometimes you love someone and you keep that in your heart. It's a silent love. This is not mawaddah, this is hub. You love someone and you say, I love this person, you don't show it. Mawaddah means showing the love. With the Ahlul Bayt, we are required to show our love. And this is why the Arba'een walk, where millions walk to the grave of Imam al-Hussein, this is one of the best means of showing mawaddah to the Ahlul Bayt. Today, there is no Muslim that says, I don't love the Ahlul Bayt. All Muslims, wherever you go, they will tell you, yes, we love the Ahlul Bayt. But only the Shias show their love to the Ahlul Bayt. Only the followers of the Ahlul Bayt, the true followers of the Ahlul Bayt, they show it through their aza, through their majalis, through their ziyara. This is the means of showing the love. So the first category is the Ahlul Bayt, and the second group that we are ordered to show mawaddah, show our love to, is the family. Do we show our love to the family? Maybe you find one person, he knows how to show love to the Ahlul Bayt, but there's no love within the family. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. What does it mean to show love? It means to show the love, connect, communicate with the family. Today you find many people, they don't know how to communicate with one another. It's very difficult for them to communicate. Rasulullah, he says, لِبَقَاءِ أَحَدُكُمْ عِنْدَ أَهْلِهِ أَفْضَلْ مِنَ الْإِعْتِكَافِ فِي مَسْجِدِ هَذَا. He says, for someone to have a quality relationship with his family and stays with his family for 1 hour, where this person has a quality time, spends quality time with his or her family, that is better than i'tikaf in the masjid of Rasulullah. This is what Rasulullah wants from us. Rasulullah says, if you were to spend 1 hour with your family, quality time. I'm not talking about the hours that are spent, each one is on the computer, one is on the phone, one is in the kitchen, each one is doing their own thing. It may be quality time, but quality time is when you sit and you see the needs of each one. You see the needs of each family member. My children, they have needs. Have I given them their needs? Maybe I know how to give my children a roof over their head. Maybe I know how to give them money. Maybe I know how to send them to college. But have I given them the need of spirituality? Have I fed the need to have a father that they want to talk to? Many of us, we don't talk to our children. You know, and children, they have a habit, and this is because of their innocence. They come and they want to talk to their parents at a young age. But the parents, they keep telling their children, I'm busy, not right now, leave me alone, I'm busy. Eventually, once the child becomes 14, 15, 16, the child does not even talk to their parents anymore. Then the parents, they come and they say, my son does not talk to me anymore. My daughter does not talk to me anymore. Yes, this is because they found someone else that will listen to them. They found someone else that will talk to them. This is why the religion of Islam stresses on the importance of family from day one. From day one, spend quality time with your family, because that will be better than i'tikaf in the masjid of Rasulullah. These are the akhlaq of Islam. These are the values of the religion of Islam. Rasulullah, he says, the best woman, the best of your wives, they are the one, خير نسائكم الولود الودود المتبرجة عند زوجها الحصان عند غيره الذي تحفظه في نفسها وماله. Rasulullah, he says, the best of the woman, the best of your wives, the best of your woman, they are al-walud, the childbearing. This is, of course, if she can have a child. Al-walud, al-wadud. The second is the one that shows love. There are some wives, every wife says, I love my husband. But there are some wives that show love more than the others. And there are others that don't show love at all. Rasulullah, he says, al-walud, al-wadud, the one who has wadda, mawadda, from the word mawadda, showing the love. And then, al-mutabarraja anda zawjiha, the one who shows her beauty in front of her husband. What has the society showed us? Today, this society, the multi-billion dollar makeup industry, where is the makeup used most of the time? Inside the house or outside the house? Unfortunately, it's used outside the house, and inside the house, there's no sign of it. المتبرجه عند زوجها الحصان عند غيره. But in front of others, she is very modest. In front of others, very proper hijab. The one who protects her husband with her body and with his wealth and her wealth. Rasulullah, he says, the best of the men, they are the ones who show love. They are the ones who show compassion to their wives. Rasulullah says, if one of you men, if you tell your wife, I love you, this will not leave her heart. Maybe for the man, it might be something very simple, saying, I love you. Maybe it doesn't mean anything for some people. But for the woman, for your wife, it means a lot. And Rasulullah, he says, show love to your family. Tell your wife you love her. Because Allah will reward you if you do so. You will take reward from Allah just by doing that. But unfortunately today, there's no communication within the family. And if communication is lost, there's going to be no love. So the first is showing mawaddah. Satisfying the needs of the family members. There are some families, each member in the family, they have their own needs. Sometimes it's a physical need. Sometimes it's a spiritual need. Sometimes it's a financial need. Any type of need, the family is there to help one another out. The family is there to support one another. And if every member in the family, they fulfill their needs. If I fulfill my role towards my parents, the parents, they fulfill their role to their children, the spouses, they fulfill their role to one another, their responsibility, you won't find problems within the family. You won't find fighting and arguments and divorce rates. Today, we see many families falling apart. Why? Because there's no mercy in the family. And the second tool, the second thing that Allah says, the first was, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً. There has to be love. And the second condition is that there has to be rahmah. There has to be mercy within the family. Today, you see, there's so much fighting, there's so much arguments. There's no mercy. We are supposed to have mercy within our family. Forgive. Forgive the family members. Why do people get divorced? Because someone did something to oppress the other person. Someone hurt the other one. Then they don't want to forgive one another. But Allah says there has to be mercy within the family. You have to forgive. If you don't forgive your own family, then who are you going to forgive? And Allah says, I like the one who forgives. The one who forgives other people, I like this quality. Because on the day of judgment, I will forgive this person. If someone expects Allah to show mercy with him, then Allah expects this person to show mercy with other people. Show mercy to the people. Show mercy to the creation. Allah says in the Quran, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. The quality of the muhsin. If you want to be a muhsin, one that does good, Allah says, الْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ, the ones who control their anger. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and forgiving other people. Of course, the reward of forgiving a family member is greater than forgiving a stranger. So if you forgive your family, even if they have oppressed you, even if they have done something wrong, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. Show love and show mercy. Don't let your family be your worst enemy. Today there are some people, the families, they are worst enemies with one another. The enemy is not someone far. The worst enemy is inside the house. The one who all of the fueled hatred is directed to. Allah says in the Quran about the wives, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Treat your wives with kindness. Treat your wives with equality. فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُوهُنَّ فَعَسَىٰ أَنْ تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah says, if you hate them, you might be hating someone or something that Allah has made a lot of khair in that thing. A lot of good comes out of that thing. This is Allah speaking about the wives. Allah says, show love, show mercy, show compassion to your family members. وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Deal with them with ma'roof, with kindness, with equality when you deal with your family. So this is the second. First is mawadda. The first is showing love and connecting. The second is forgiving. And the third, if you really want to love your family, you have to guide your family. You have to show your family the right way. There are many of us, we love our family, but we only think about the family, the future in this life. We focus about the college education. We worry about the house. We worry about the marriage. We worry about things that have to do with this life. How many of us worry about the afterlife of our family? How many of us do dua for the afterlife of the family? How many of us guide our family? How many of us do amr bil ma'roof? How many of us show our children how to reach Allah, how to reach spirituality? Unfortunately, there's no spirituality in this society. Very little spirituality. So if I want to reach spirituality, if I want to take my children to spirituality, if I want to lead my family to spirituality, then I must show them the way. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. O you people who believe, strengthen yourselves and strengthen your family from the hellfire that is fueled with people and rocks. Allah says, protect your family. Do dua for your family. Think of the afterlife of your family, because we will be held accountable. If I came to a society and I did not care for the afterlife of my children, I did not teach my children salah, I did not teach them Quran, I did not make sure that my family members, each person in the family is praying, is following the rules of Allah and the rules of Islam, on the day of judgment, Allah will tell me, why did you not? Why did you not care for your family? Why did you not care for the afterlife? You knew how to care for the life of your family, but you did not know how to care for the afterlife of your family. And the real life is the afterlife. That is the eternal life. This is the short-term life that everyone will leave. So if I really care for my children, if I really love my family, then I worry about their afterlife. I pray for them. I guide them. I make sure I show them the right way. Allah says in the Quran, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Allah says, order your family to pray and be extra patient. Allah does not say be patient. Allah says, wastabir alayha, meaning monitor them, meaning watch them, meaning convince them, do whatever you have to make sure that they are praying. Because if they don't pray, then they will lose the afterlife. As-salat amududdin, salah is the pillar of faith. If I don't make sure that my children and my family are praying, then they do not have a foundation. Another issue is to do amr bil ma'roof and nahi an al munkar, enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. Amr bil ma'roof is one of the furu' ad-deen, one of the wajibat. But how many of us actually practice this? We pray, we go to hajj, we do all of our wajibat. How many of us actually practice amr bil ma'roof and nahi an al munkar? A minority. When you see someone doing something wrong, even if this is your friend, even if this is your family, are you going to tell this person this is haram? This is amr bil ma'roof and nahi an al munkar. And this is what Imam al-Husayn teaches us. His whole stand, his whole revolt was for the sake of amr bil ma'roof and nahi an al munkar. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala. Imam al-Husayn, he sacrificed the closest thing he had to him, and that was his family, for the sake of Allah, and for the sake of amr bil ma'roof and nahi an al munkar. The family of Imam al-Husayn, they lost their father. They lost everything. Imam al-Husayn, on the day of Ashura, after he fell from the horse, he couldn't get up anymore. He turned to Allah during that moment and he began to do munajat. He began turning to Allah. Ilahi taraktu al-khalqa turran fi hawaka وأيتمت العيال لكي أراك. Oh Allah, I have left the creation for your sake, and I have orphaned my children for your sake, for your satisfaction. فلو قطعتني بالسيف عربا لما حن الفؤاد إلى سواك. إلهي رضا بقضائك صبرا على بلائك لا معبود سواك أغثني يا غياث المستغيثين. He says, oh Allah, I want your satisfaction. Even if I lose my family, even if I lose the closest people to me, as if this brings your satisfaction, then I am satisfied even if I am cut up with the sword, as long as you will be with me, O Allah. And then he says, أغثني يا غياث المستغيثين. Help me, O helper of the ones who ask for help. The family of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, they were left all alone. They spent 3 days in Karbala crying for Imam al-Husayn and doing ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn. Then they began heading back to Medina, the city of Rasulullah. Now they are going back without Imam al-Husayn, without Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas, without Ali al-Akbar, without Qasim. They're going back only women. They left Medina with the men with them. Now they're going back with only the women. As they get close to Medina, Imam Zain al-Abidin, he sees one of his companions by the name of Bishr ibn Hadlam. He tells him, oh, Bishr, you're a poet, just like your father was a poet. I want you to enter Medina and eulogize Imam al-Hussein. Let them know that Imam al-Hussein has been killed. Bishr, he goes to Medina. He begins calling out with his loudest voice, Ya Ahla Yathrib, la muqam lakum biha. Ya Ahla Yathrib, la muqam lakum biha. O people of Yathrib, O people of Medina, the city of Rasulullah is not a place to live in anymore. They would tell him why. What has happened? He tells them, Al-Khabar عند قبر رسول الله. I will tell you next to the grave of Rasulullah. So that we give Rasulullah the first, we mourn Imam al-Hussein by the grave of his grandfather, Rasulullah. They gather around him. What has happened, O Bish? He says, Ya Ahla Yathrib, la muqam lakum biha. Qutil al-Hussein. Qutil al-Hussein bi Karbala. Hussein has been killed. He begins eulogizing and mourning Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. They begin crying. The people of Medina, they hold the aza for Imam al-Hussein. He says, then a lady, she came to me. She was carrying a child on her shoulder. She tells me, oh Bishr, tell me about my son Hussein. He says, I asked, who was this lady? They told me, this is Ummul Banin, the mother of Abbas and the brothers of Abbas. He tells her, oh, Ummul Banin, عظم الله لك الأجر بولدك عثمان. Oh, Ummul Banin, may Allah give you patience for the loss of Uthman. She tells her son Uthman, the brother of Abbas, she tells him, tell me about my son Hussein. He tells her, oh, Ummul Banin, may Allah give you patience for your son Ja'far. She tells him, tell me about my son Hussein. He tells her, oh, Ummul Banin, may Allah give you patience for your son Abdullah. She says, tell me about Hussein. He tells her, O Ummul Banin, عظم الله لك الأجر بولدك أبي الفضل العباس. May Allah give you patience for أبي الفضل العباس. She tells him, you have broken my heart. Tell me about my son Hussein. He tells her, يا أم البنين, عظم الله لك الأجر بأبا عبد الله. O Umm al-Banin, may Allah give you patience for the loss of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Al-Ali al-Azim, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'oon. Nas'aluka Allahumma wa nad'uuk. بسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. 10 times with your loudest voices. يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله الله يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات. إنك مجيب الدعوات. إنك غافر الخطيئات. إنك على كل شيء قدير. وصلى الله على محمد وآل محمد.